Well, today is a wonderful day. So we started a few sessions back. It's only been a couple of sessions, but it feels like longer, where we talked about our average rate of change and our thinking about slopes. And then we said, hey, you know, this notion we can find a slope of a tangent line by getting our secant lines closer and closer and closer. And then we said, well, wait. What do we mean by closer and closer? And so we took a big detour. And we spent some time talking about limits. Now, we have our tool. We know how to really get into what it means to be closer and closer and to do some analysis. So, time to jump back in. We're getting into what feels like more calculus stuff. And so our goal for today is talk about slopes of tangent lines and introduce the derivative. So, let's get into it. So we have the picture where we've been looking at. So we have our function here, and we have this line, and we said, look, here's these secant lines, and secant lines are easy to find. Tangent lines are a little bit harder. Secant lines have 2 points, tangent lines have 1. It's 2 to 1. Well, it's really hard when you're down by a point. So what was our idea? Well, we were moving B closer to A, and we said, hey, I can find the slope of a secant line, which we call an average rate of change. So I'm going to take that closer and closer. And now we know closer and closer means limit. And as we take the limit of the average rate of change, we get the instantaneous rate of change. So that's our derivative. So now we know. So that f prime of a, that's our notation. So if I have a If this is the function f of x, and I know, what's the slope at the point A, we call it f prime of a. All right, so again, f prime of a, it means many things. It's our instantaneous rate of change, how the function is behaving locally at A. In other words, if I were to, say, zoom in and say, well, what does this function look like? It looks like a line, and what's the slope of that line? We call that f prime of a. And it's going to be a really important tool. And you're going to see it. It seems a pretty simple idea. But really what we're doing is we're understanding how the function is changing. And understanding change really helps us fundamentally unlock what's going on. So this is a good time. Now, we introduced the derivative by saying it's a limit as b goes to a of f of b minus f of a over b minus a. Most of the time when you work with derivatives, if you have to use the limit definition, and on a side note, most of the time you will not have to use the limit definition, but when you do, there's another common way to do it, and that is to say f of a plus h minus f of a over h. And we're taking the limit as h goes to 0. Now, how did we get from one to the other? Well, we're really saying, let's just change our name. So we're going to call b as a plus a little bit. So in terms of the picture, what you have is you still have your shape, and you still have your desired tangent line. So here's our tangent line that we're after. Here's our point A. What does h represent? Well, h represents how far away we want to go. So this would be a plus h, where h is a small distance, and there's our second point. So what was happening is we're going to call b as a plus h. We're changing our names. And changing names is a perfectly good and valid thing to do. In fact, it's one of our best tools, because when we change names, our real goal in doing so is let's simplify what we have. And we like things to be simple. All right, so you can see what happens. The b becomes a plus h. B minus a would be a plus h minus a, which is h. And of course, if b is getting close to a, well, if b gets close to a, that means that h has to get close to 0. So that's how we translate our pieces back and forth. Now, one thing to remember is where this definition is coming from. It's a change of the output over a change in the input. It's still the same. We haven't changed that fact. So this h here represents a very small change in the input, and that's useful to keep in mind when we talk about understanding what the derivative represents, especially when we get into some of the applications of derivatives. Now, if you're going to memorize one rule for taking derivatives, and you're probably young, and you probably can memorize two rules, but if you're only going to remember one rule, you should probably do the one in the box. Why the one in the box? Don't they give the same answer? They do. They absolutely do. 100% will give the same answer. So why is it easier to work with this expression? And I'll tell you why. This expression is easier to work with for a very simple and fundamental reason. Namely, what's going to happen is this limit, right now as it's written, goes to 0 over 0, which means you always have to do more work. So when you're computing the derivative, always, always, always more work is involved. You're never going to escape that. So when we're doing more work, one of the ways we often do that is to think about, well, if I have a 0 over a 0, I need to cancel. Something caused a 0 upstairs, and something caused a 0 downstairs. So if I can just figure out what's causing it and knock them out, then I can probably get an answer. So we want to find a way to get cancellation. You'll notice in this expression, f of b minus f of a over b minus a, I'd have to get a b minus a upstairs if I wanted to cancel what's downstairs. Okay, well, it's possible, but it's not so clear sometimes how to extract a b minus a. On the other hand, in this version, we just have to get an h. If I can just find a single h upstairs, victory, we've made it. So this is why this is the one we will almost always use. But like I say, know both. All right, so now we can talk about our slope of our tangent line. And so we should just talk about the tangent line. We're going to call this several different names over the course of the next few sessions. So it's good to know what it is. So the way I like to think of the tangent line is it's doing the best job that any line can to approximate what the function is doing at the point A. So that says if you zoom in, so do your pinch zoom, your curve, which could be all sorts of wiggly, becomes very flat, and that flat thing is the tangent line. So what do we mean by it's doing its best job to approximate? Well, it's mimicking what the function behaves like. And we know that it touches the function. That's the word tangent. Tangent means to touch. So at the point A, f of a, that's a point on the tangent line. And f prime of a is the slope of the line. So in some sense, you could say the tangent line is storing two pieces of information. And in fact, I want to go ahead and make this really clear, because there's this really nice idea. And if you can get this idea early, then you can start to see how to work with tangent lines. So here we go. If I have the tangent line at to f of x at x equals a. Okay, so that's my box here represents a piece of information. This is what I currently have. It's the same as having the following two pieces of information. Namely, I have what is the value of the function at a and what is the derivative or the slope at a. So if I know these two pieces of information, then I know my tangent line. And I should have said, of course, I also assume I know what a is. So if I know what the value of the function is at the point A, and I know what the derivative of the function is at the point A, I know what the tangent line is. Conversely, if I know what the tangent line is, I can recover these two pieces of information. How do I do it? Well, the slope of the tangent line is my derivative. How do I get the function at A? Well, I have to touch the function at A. So the point on the line at A is the same as the value of the function at A. So oftentimes we might be given, oh, here's a tangent line. Let me jump over to this piece. oh, here's stuff I know about the function, manipulate, then I can jump back if needed. So there's a couple ways to write tangent lines. So this is, sometimes you call this point-slope formula, the y minus the y-coordinate, that's your f of a, is equal to your slope, so that's f prime of a, times x minus your x-coordinate, x minus a. Then, well, I could add f of a to both sides. So y is equal to f of a plus f prime of a times x minus a. And of course, you can then rearrange. For instance, if you want to get it into slope-intercept form, if you distribute the f prime of a through, you get that y is the f prime of a times x, and that's why we talk about the derivative is the slope of the tangent line. And then there's this other stuff, f of a minus a f prime of a. So that's just your f of a and then minus a f prime of a. That's your intercept. We don't often do that, but we can get it if we need it. Now, which is the form you should use? The answer is you should use which form the question asks, and if it doesn't tell you, you can really feel comfortable doing it in any of these forms. That being said, I will say that there's a nice foreshadowing of things to come. This is a really nice way to think about the tangent line because it sets us up to be in a good position to think about approximation of functions. That's going to happen in Calc 2. So, if you have a choice, this is where to go. All right, well, that's the basic idea. But before we leave, I want to talk about what is probably the single hardest thing for taking derivatives. Well, I should say there are two hard things. One thing is that people forget parentheses. Parentheses are your friends. Don't leave them out. Always include parentheses if you can, because they're there to help you get points, you know, all the points. We don't want to get the wrong answer. But when I say that there's the hardest part about taking derivatives, all right, so let's do a little sidebar here. Suppose I say that f of x is x squared. All right, we'll just start with a very simple function. All right, what is f of 2? The answer is it's 2 squared. All right, you probably saw that. F of pi is? It's pi squared. All right, cool. What if I said f of y? What is that? Yeah, it's y squared. Okay, so far so good. What about f of a cat? Now you're probably thinking, this is nonsense. You can't plug a cat into this function. What are you talking about? And I say, I can. It's cat squared. That's what f of a cat is. Now, it's true that I can't go any further because it's like, well, I don't know how to square a cat. That's not it. That's cats aren't don't like to be squared. But that's what it is. I'm following the rule. You see, when we write a function like this, it's rule. It says, well, whatever you put into your function, you take it and you square. Now, what's the punchline? Why am I bringing this up? When I talk about f of a plus h, a lot of people get stumped on this because they're like, what do I do with the plus h? The answer is, what are you plugging in? Well, we're plugging in a plus h. And the rule says, whatever you plug in, you square it. And therefore, this would be a plus h squared. Just like when we plugged in a cat, we got a cat squared. So if we plug in a plus h, it's a plus h squared. So understand, you know, how do functions work? They're rules, they're mechanisms. So usually we write f of x equals some expression of stuff involving x. So whatever you plug in, whatever the x is, put that in into the various places in that formula and use parentheses. So you see how that's a plus h squared. For one thing, you'll see that f of a plus h is not, in our case, a squared plus h. See, when you plug in this plus h, it's not just that you add a plus h onto the end. This is important. And if you can get this, then a lot of the algebraic manipulations and using the limit definition to take derivatives, is going to be a lot better. Well, we want things to be better. That's our goal. All right, good. Well, time for some practice.